talking.
Yeah, because I'm...
You start talking before I finish.
Do you know what the problem is, Mark? You never stop talking.
Hi, I'm Meet Katie, and this is Lowering the Tone. I finally did it. Finally set up my own show. Quite excited as it goes. We've been talking about this for quite a while now, but if anyone's interested in getting involved and helping with this podcast, please just email me on mark@meetkatie.com. And don't forget to put in the subject title, Lowering the Tone. Just to give you an idea of the format of this show, I'm going to do a mix right now for about half an hour, something a bit more up-tempo, a bit pacey, stuff I normally play. Then I'm going to drop it down for another half an hour or so. Then I have an interview with Micah Black from Black & Blunts. Great DJ, wicked producer, all-round good guy, really. And very interesting. If you get a moment, head over to my website, it's www.meetkatie.com, and subscribe to the mailing list. That way I can keep you updated, send you a track listing for the show. Just general spam, really. Right, it's probably time I shut up and played some music like I said I would.
You're listening to Meet Katie on Lowering the Tone. listening to Meet Katie on Lowering the Tone.
Into him. Thank you.
Many thanks to those that made it out to Pineapple Tribe Sound System at Notting Hill Carnival last weekend. What pie. And thanks to all the guys that put me on. It's really appreciated. Pleased to say that they invited me back next year, so I think it went well. I'm also going to be playing their party at Brixton Jam on the 27th of September. That'll be with Beta and the Plum DJs, who always smash it, so that's a pretty good one. Also, it's Red Eye playing London, so if you can make it out, show a bit of support. There's a few people I'd like to give a shout out. One being Sean Gallagher. The original concept for this podcast was hatched at an after party around his house one night in San Francisco. Originally, it was all going to be chat. I wasn't going to play any music. We're just going to talk about people and pitch, I guess. Still going to do that. Still have that element, which is always going to be at the back half of this podcast, where I interview people. Hopefully get into some areas that are interesting, and hopefully you find it interesting. Somebody else I'd like to give a shout to is Nicole and Memo, really good friends of mine. Miss you like mad. Also Dulce, Sid Griss, the Opulent crew. You're all going to be at Burning Man right now. Unfortunately, I'm not going. Gutted. Someone else I'd like to give a shout to is Simon Norford. He's out in Croatia at the Hideout Festival with Dopamine, a bunch of other friends. Shouts to Ainsley, Nick, Gemma. I've got Matt Dopamine coming in the studio next week to do an interview. I'm sure that'd be funny. That's if he's recovered by then. If there's anyone that you think I should be talking to or interviewing or playing their music, hit me up at mark@mekatie.com and I will do my best to respond to each and every one of you. Can't guarantee it. If you email me telling me how great you are as a DJ or a producer, let me be the judge of that. I'll have a listen to your music. If it's been there, I'll play it. If I'm not, you probably won't get an email back. I know that's a bit harsh, but it's the truth. I've got a bit more music to come, and then we got this interview with Micah Black. Thank you.
for that. Just an ordinary day. Till you came around, and now my life's upside down. Imagine that. And it's all because I heard you say. And it's all because I heard you say. And it's all because I walked your way.
Listening to Lowering the Tone with me, Katie.
I'm going to head off into a kind of deeper territory right now. This is music that I really like. I just don't get a chance to play it in my sets. I'm sure you can imagine how frustrating that is as a DJ, not being able to play music that you really like to people for fear of them not dancing. So I guess this is one of the reasons why having a podcast is good. We'll be right back.
Listening to Make Katie on Lowering the Tone.
I hope you're enjoying the show so far. Keeping it pretty low slung right now. There's a lot more to come though.
Thank you. It's a lonely night. Everybody's happy. Been turning around, looking for a friendly light. But I see nothing. No eyes. No eyes on me. It's a lonely night, everybody's happy. Been turning around, looking for a friendly light. But I see nothing, no eyes.
You're listening to Meet Katie on Lowering the Tone.
It's all right.
You're listening to Meet Katie on Lowering the Tone.
Thanks for listening to my deeper selection. We're going to move on now. So now it's that time we've all been waiting for. A few weeks back, Micah Black from Black and Blunt came to my house, travelled down into the furthest depths of the suburbs, and we've done this little interview.
Exclusive.
Right, where do I start? Why are you here?
I'm just in the UK over, I've just been at in Europe at Kazantip and in Germany, just doing some shows. First time in the Ukraine at Kazantip, that was a pretty amazing festival. Just played with the In Beats We Trust guys from Russia,
Lady Wax
yeah. And you know, Lexani and Quest and all those guys, and also with Martin Hauger and Leroy Thornhill and... Just, yeah, sort of 5 days, five gigs, lots of different stages, lots of sun, lots of crazy nights full of, you know, Russian vodka and Ukrainian people rocking out. And it was amazing.
Nice.
Yeah, it was really good. There's like lots of stages along the beach there and kind of played like two or three of them. And then this bar called the UFO Bar, I played that a couple of times. And that was definitely where the party was at each and every night. About 5 a.m, it was just going mental.
That's perfect time.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know. People, as a rule, go out a lot later. So, you know, especially at festivals.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some festivals, they run during the day and then they kind of finish up at night, you know, and sort of everyone kind of quietens down or there's like after shows and that sort of stuff. But this party definitely, it starts around midnight. I mean, there's stuff running during the day. But I think between about 6 and 10, everything kind of stops. Everyone goes and has a bit of rest. And then it fires back up again at about midnight. And then, just goes through till 7, 8, 9 in the morning. Just keeps going.
I played out there. I saw Marco Bailey. And I mentioned to you before. Mm. The thing that absolutely amazed me about it was that his set sort of gained pace as the light came up, which is normally when people kind of move away and it's like, oh, the light's out. You know, by the end of his set, there was just, because it backed onto the beach, there was people dancing in the sea. You know, it was an incredible sight. You know, he was playing some fantastic music, but to see a set sort of ramp up as it got light, you know, was kind of, you know, a bit of a new experience. They normally wind down when the sun comes up.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I've ever seen like that is Exit Festival. In Serbia, sort of on the dance stage there, that it just kind of ramps up and up and up and up and up and up until about 8-9 a.m. and then kind of just finishes on a high note. It doesn't bliss out at all. It just kind of keeps getting heavier and heavier.
I've never been to Exit. I've had some fantastic reports from it. It's something
it's really
I'd love
good.
To do, but
yeah. In a big castle in Serbia.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Serbia have come a long way.
They have. They have.
Anyway, so you're over, you came from what, like more of a pleasure or,
just a bit
to
of
the
both.
UK, you know?
Yeah, well, to the UK, I just came to catch up with friends. It's, I can't come to the Northern Hemisphere and not, you know, see people like yourself and just friends that I've got over here, the Plumps guys, Jeanette Slack, and just some old Perth friends that, you know, have moved over here and are living over here. It's sort of, it's easy to skip over to the UK for a week and just catch up with everybody and then head back to Perth because obviously I don't get over here. I haven't been here in maybe 3 years, 4 years.
Really, that long?
Yeah, it's been a while. I was coming every year for a while and then just everything started ramping up in Australia and I've just been really, really busy there.
Well, thank you for coming down and chatting to me.
No worries, mate.
Obviously, we've had dinner before this and it's lovely seeing you anyway.
Yeah.
But you're hobbling.
I think, you know, Kazan tip injury, I stacked it on a bit of an excessively fun night out, I think after much drinking and much frivolity, but yeah, I stacked it and I've damaged myself, but you know, it's a good story and a good bit of you know, rave injury to kind of take home.
I think it's a sign of having a good weekend when you come back with some kind of injury.
Yeah.
You know, I normally end up black and blue. And like my favourite parties, I normally have hurt myself like to some kind of
some
degree.
Yeah. Well, I did an interesting thing to get myself over to Kazan Tip. I raised the money through crowdfunding.
Oh, really?
I there's a website called Possible in Australia where they kind of run the back end for a crowdfunding project. So what I did is I did a video and wrote up a kind of a little bio and then put it up on the website and then sent it out to my network in Perth and in Australia. And everybody can kind of contribute money and, you know, they don't contribute money for nothing. So I gave away some music. I gave away some DJ lessons, some production lessons. I've got a DJ at some people's parties and that sort of stuff. So there was a reward system. So yeah, it was a really, really interesting way to raise the money.
What's the name of the website?
Possible. POZIBLE.com.au.
That's a great
idea. There's other sites around the world. Crowdfunding's becoming a pretty popular way for people, particularly musicians and artists, startup businesses, that kind of stuff, to kind of get their projects off the ground. And, you know, for somebody like me who, got the opportunity to play at Kazan Tip, but didn't have the funds to kind of get myself over there. It was a really good way to get the money together. And it's a really interesting way to sort of, I don't know, see the support that, you know, that you have in the community.
Yeah, that you've built up.
Yeah. It's really interesting. I mean, I to be honest, I was shitting myself. I was really, really scared because, you know, even on the website, there's a meter that goes up as the money kind of goes up. And the deal is if you don't make your target, you don't get any money.
So like Kickstarter type vibe.
Yeah. And so I thought, oh, this is going to be a really kind of spectacular way to fail miserably in front of everybody that I know.
In front of all your fans.
And all my fans and shit. Look, I raised $3,500 in 3 days. The whole campaign ran for 30 days. I reached my target in 10 days. And then it kept going for the rest of the days. I ended up raising about $6,500.
That's amazing.
It was amazing. It really, really blew me away. I couldn't believe how ready people are to just get involved and support somebody that in trying to achieve something that they want to achieve. And everybody was really, really positive about it. I'd see people out at the club and at an Ambar or just out at festivals and that sort of stuff, and they'd say, "Oh, you know, I put my $5 in, or I put my $10 in," and you know, like they were just, and they said, "You know, great, good luck. You know, it's really, really wonderful opportunity. It's so good to, you know, be able to kind of help you." And they're just people want to get involved and they want to help, and it's a really kind of humbling.
Well, I think that's testament to yourself, to be fair, because as soon as I mentioned I was going to interview you this afternoon, well, this evening, you know, immediately people from Perth are all liking it. People that, you know, I know from Perth, you know, and the first comment was representing Perth, you know, you're extremely popular, DJ, you know, but also the sort of man behind the scenes as well. You know, this is, you know, to sort of get onto to Perfect Self. You're not just a DJ in the city, you know. No. You're famous for being a DJ, but you're actually more involved in a lot of the projects and how they develop and you know, working for Ambar, which, you know, for anyone that doesn't know what Ambar is, Ambar is like, you know, probably the number one club in Australia. For me, it is. It's been, you know, an absolute rock in the clubbing calendar. You know, whenever I get a gig there, I look forward to it. It's something that really excites me, like playing at, you know, sort of one of my favourite festivals or something. It's something that I always get very excited about.
Yeah.
And you're a very instrumental and influential person at that club.
Yeah, I started out as a resident there, maybe like 11 years ago. I celebrated 10 years there last year, and just over the years, it became my home. It's my home, and I'm really, really passionate about my home and about making sure that it is the kind of club that I want to play at, and it has the music, the kind of music that I want to listen to, and also the kind of family that I want to be around. Family and community is really, really important to me, and it's something that that's kept Ambar going for, you know, 13 years now, is that it has a really strong community behind it, and all the DJs are very supportive of each other. There's no kind of competition amongst everybody there. Everybody just really gives each other a leg up and supports each other. The crowd are a part of the foundations of the club. You know, there are people that have been going there as long as I've been DJing there and that still come there, you know, not every week maybe, but like, you know, monthly, and when we do our big shows, and then when certain artists come through, like yourself, or, you know, they come back and continually kind of support those artists and those people. And it's, since I work for the for Boomtick, the kind of the greater organization that runs Ambar, and my role is, I guess, to kind of curate the music. It's been a really big just sort of focus for me to just keep that spirit alive, keep that community kind of and energy alive, and keep it the club that that I want to be at, and that our punters and our family want to be at.
I think community is the right word. You know, I think that's why a lot of, you know, like touring DJs, they like it so much, because you go back there and it's like seeing a really good friend that you haven't seen for a little while.
Mm.
And you don't need to start again. You just pick up from where you left off.
Yeah.
You know, you've obviously changed, stuff's going on, but that's what a good friend is, and that's what a good club is.
Yeah. I mean, you were one of the people that actually, like, early on in the day sort of said something to me which really stuck. You know, I remember we were sort of standing at the bar and you sort of said, you know, I hope you realise that you guys have got something pretty special going on here. You know, there's not many clubs that you can come back to time and time again that are the same in terms of the energy and the community kind of aspect and the crowd. And that kind of really stuck with me, and it sort of made me realise that we were on the right track, you know.
Yeah, I think the kids are, like, the new to clubbing and new to the Ambar, they kind of almost inherit goodwill from the people that slow down, that have families, that, you know, like, that back off from clubbing. They leave this sort of almost leave such a good taste in your mouth, a good like legacy for people to pick up. And, you know, and because, you know, like, everything moves, like, everything changes, everything does move, but I think the core values at Ambar have remained the same from the beginning, and it was good, and it still is good, and that's that's why I think people hold it in such high regard.
Yeah, and it's that's something that, you know, since I've been there and been, you know, I guess in, that's been my mandate for myself to pass that mantle on, and a lot of that comes down to the DJs that we, you know, our residents have changed and grown and over the years, but the new guys that have come through are the guys that recognize that legacy and have the desire to carry that legacy on, because you know, in Perth, it everybody come, the feedback that I get is that it has a different feeling from all the other clubs in Perth, and you know, and almost in Australia, because there is that community aspect there and that love and passion for the venue. I mean, the clientele that come down, they're passionate about the venue. They love the music. They support the DJs, but they're passionate about the venue and about just everything that's going on there. Well,
talking of which, you're in the process of moving.
Yeah, look, we at the beginning of the year, we kind of got served with a notice from the building that Ambar's in. It's sort of at the bottom of about a three-story building underneath, and you know, sort of backs onto the car park. And they want to redevelop the building, so we have to move, which is at first was kind of a real blow. You know, when Liam, who owns the business, you know, kind of sat me down and sort of handed me the letter and, you know, said, look, I need
you.
We
should probably say hi to Liam.
Yeah, hi, Liam.
Hi, Liam.
You know, it was a bit of a blow. And then, you know, for us to kind of to sit on it for a while, you know, and before we could kind of come to a place where we could let everybody know, because it was still a bit up in the air. We didn't know what the time frame was. We didn't know, you know, we needed to kind of make the message, you know, one of a positive nature, because we're not closing, we're moving. We've got another venue ready to go. It's 100 meters away from the existing venue.
Oh, really? It's
yeah.
So close.
Yeah, it's right. Really, really close. So it's still in the same part of Perth, and it's still, you know, it's going to be, we're not going to change anything in terms of our formula. We're going to have the same music. We're going to have similar promoters that are promoting other nights in there, and, you know, the same staff and the same door staff, and, you know, and so, but it's, you know, it's a scary thought. You know, if the term is, if it ain't broken, don't fix it, you know.
That's
so
it, yeah, to move is,
yeah.
But, you know, moving venues, you know, it could, you know, same breath. I know from running my own nights, you know, when we've moved venues, you know, it's become exciting again, you know, just a change of scenery.
Absolutely. And that's what it is for us now. We're really excited about this new venue. It's a very similar size to Ambar. It's even got columns down the middle of the venue, existing. Yeah, the existing venue does. We can actually go in there and put the bar in the same spot, put the DJ in the same spot, because they're two kind of key things that really work for the venue. The DJ is in, you know, they're a high five away, so they're kind of right in the middle of the crowd. But and the dance floor is kind of big enough, but not too big. So, you know, it fills up quite easily and packs out quite nicely, but then, you know, the bar's in a good spot. Just that, you know, we're not going to change the layout. That's going to remain the same. But, you know, just the venue's going to change, and it's going to be great because we're going to be in it from the ground up. Like, Ambar developed over 13 years into what it is now. And it's undergone slight changes and improvements, but there are some key things that the infrastructure that really need to be, that really need a working over. And when, you know, going into this new venue, we can make it exactly how we want it, because we've had the Ambar for 13 years. We know what works, but we know it needs to be better, and now we can go in and make that better. So we're really excited to kind of get into this new venue.
Well, there, so am I.
Yeah. Yeah, you'll be back. You'll be back for sure.
Talking of Australia and obviously Perth, with regards to Ambar and the residents, like your production partner, Philly Blunt, he's a resident as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Is this how you met? Or
yeah. Look,
we started working together.
Yeah. We've known each other. He was another local DJ like I was. I actually met his girlfriend first through the inthemix.com.au kind of forums, you know, about 10 years ago. That was where you could start getting your name out and, you know, post and gig information. That's kind of before the world of Facebook and all that sort of stuff. That's where forums was a big community.
Forums were the way.
That's the way that, you know, and In the Mix was kind of the Australian forum. And so I met his girlfriend Megs, and she actually interviewed me really early on in my career, and then I got to know Phil through just kind of DJing out in the community, and then about sort of 6 years ago he came on board as one of the residents, And, you know, he's just been killing it over there. He's
a good DJ. You guys work really well together. I came here, you play. I stayed an extra day.
Yeah, I did.
I stayed an extra day and I caught one of your sets with Heavy Feet.
Yeah, Heavy Feet. We played after him.
That's
right.
And, you absolutely slammed it. I stayed for the whole duration. What surprised me how comfortable you were, you playing together is... You know, lots of DJs go, oh, you know, we play together. And they got their own agenda. You know, they want to be, you know, want to be part of a project, but they want to be the star of a project. You guys kind of were very fluid. You know, there was never a moment where I looked over to Dex and thought, oh, you know, it was very comfortable. And you were playing multi-genre set, you know, which is even more dynamic. You guys were playing, you know, garage to drum and bass. It was like the tempos were incredibly all over the place, but there was a real natural feel and flow, and that's what really impressed me. You know, obviously I signed you to my label, but beyond that, I was like, these guys are killing it. This is great.
Oh, thanks, man. We're both pretty, I guess. I don't know. We both got a kind of a lot of humility around our music, and about like we're not, neither of us kind of really seek out the spotlight. So we sort of we give each other a lot of space to just do it, each other's thing, and we communicate quite a lot in the booth in terms of tempo shifting and that sort of stuff. We sort of, you know, oh, what do you reckon? We go down here now, but. It's why we've been able to work well together in the studio as well, is because we, you know, as you know, sometimes you get in the studio with somebody and it doesn't kind of work, and we just seem to have a natural sort of agreement that we're going in the right direction. It's not often in the studio that we're kind of heading in different directions, you know, and so it's the same in the DJ booth. We sort of naturally feel like we're going in the right direction together, and it's we just sort of give each other space to kind of do our thing and be you know kind of together up in there and work together, because we want to be up there and be together in it. We don't want to kind of just be two DJs DJing, you know, at the same time. We want to be Black and Blunt and have that kind of put forward as a united front. And you know, we're really good friends. We do a radio show together. We obviously spend a lot of time in the studio together, and we've just kind of, it's kind of, you know, the friendship's developed naturally, even though it hasn't really been that long. I mean, it's, you know, maybe like 6 years or so, you know, it's sort of not a, like a hell of a long time, well, but
marriages don't last.
Yeah.
Sometimes that long.
Exactly. So yeah, you know, and I mean, Phil's an amazing producer. You know, really good DJ.
He's a good lad as well.
He's a really nice guy. And so, you know, it's just, you know, I couldn't ask for somebody better to kind of be writing music and playing music with. And, you know, we tour together, and yeah, we tour well together, and it's just, it's a good partnership and a good friendship.
Good match.
Yeah.
So talking of production.
Yep.
Well, I know that you're putting a track together for my 100th release on Lot 49.
We are.
Which we've discussed this evening.
Yeah.
Besides that, yep. what you got lined up?
We've just been working on a bunch of original stuff. We've sort of found a little bit of a different sound that we've been trying to explore, a little bit more kind of stripped back, 808-y sort of bouncy stuff. In the kind of the 4/4 and breaks kind of realm, we were writing a lot of kind of big riffy sort of tunes, and I'm really enjoying that sort of stuff. But then we started to try and sort of strip away sort of things that didn't necessarily need to be there.
The fluff.
Yeah, the fluff, you know, and you know, extra hi-hats and that kind of stuff. So we've been working on a bunch of original stuff in that kind of vein, of which we've got, I can't remember how many, but just a couple of things that are either finished or just about there. We've done a couple of remixes. We just did a remix for Upstart Music, which I think we finished before I went away.
Right.
There's some talk of some other kind of bigger Australian artist remixes, which not kind of locked in yet, so I don't want to say anything. Yep. But hopefully they kind of come through, because they'll be really, really good. We did a big single just recently that got some like quite a bit of Triple J radio play actually, came out on Ground Level, called Wandering Strangers, and that we got like a number one on the Triple J Unearthed.
Well, funny enough, my girlfriend's Australian, mm-hmm. as you know,
yeah.
But people that are listening wouldn't know that. But why she was back home visiting her folks, she saw a piece on you. I think it was either on In The Mix. It was on one of the websites. And you were being touted as, like, you know, a very big thing. And my girlfriend phoned me immediately, like, read out the piece about you and Phil,
right?
And it was basically saying, you know, what you just said is that, like, you know, it's that there is a, you know, big riffs, you know, very, you know, kind of accessible elements, and it's kind of interesting that now you're gonna strip back the sound, but in the same breath is I feel that if you can have a kick, a snare, some hi-hats, and a riff that is infectious, it's pretty much all you need.
Yeah, look, we're both like hooks, and we like things to get a hold on to. You know, it's very important with us when we're writing our music. And when I say we're like stripping things back, we're not stripping out our kind of our big riffs and our big kind of drops and all that sort of stuff. We're just trying to make them stand out more and be more focused, and get rid of the things that don't need to be there. We're both very, very keen on, you know, I don't like to sort of say, you know, like pop music, but like the elements that pop music bring in terms of just the hooky sort of stuff, you know, and just having a big thing to kind of get onto and that drops and swings and moves and it can kind of stick in your head. And that's where we're trying to focus on making those things really, really nice, clean and spacious, but at the same time make the beats a lot kind of more bigger and simpler and more spacious to kind of just create space in everything that we do, but yet, you know, still have that energy.
Well, I think that's the holy grail, really, isn't it? Is, you know, no, I would agree with you, is that, you know, pop music as a rule is, you know, I love good pop music, you know. You know, when I hear a track on the radio and I walk away and I'm still humming that track, you know, a day later, that's a good track, you know.
Yeah.
And you know, I wouldn't take anything away from anyone that makes pop music.
Yeah.
I think it's a different element where people are trying to make, like, manufacture pop music, and they're sort of like going, well, it needs to be this, it needs to be that, and if you do this, you do that, it's going to result in this.
Yeah.
And we had a conversation earlier down the pub about disclosure.
Yeah.
And I think that's a really good example of how pop can be credible.
Absolutely.
You know,
those guys are killing it, and they're, if that's what pop music is, if that's what popular music is, then hey, like,
great.
Cheers to that, because that's what popular music should be.
Mm. You know, I couldn't agree with you more. Mm. You know, I some of their tracks, you know, one recently, and I hadn't heard before, I turned it up on the radio, I was like, oh, this sounds great, you know, and this is daytime radio.
Mm.
And I didn't even know it was them, and how honest is that?
Mm.
You know, I like their stuff. I turned it off and I was like, this is great, you know. And at the end of it, it's a new one by Disclosure. It was just like, you know, more like that, please.
Yeah, for sure. More popular music like that. It just gives me a warm, fuzzy feeling in my stomach that is where, you know, that where popular music is kind of heading, and that there is still really, truly credible artists out there writing interesting, diverse and really well-made music that is becoming popular amongst people. It's great.
It's a nice idea that you know, pop doesn't have to be cheese.
No.
You know, it's a very nice, it's a, you know, it's, to be honest, it's an inspiring idea.
Mm.
That's like why we can sit here and you say, I want to strip out all my ideas apart from the key elements,
yep.
big riffs, fill the space with, you know, stuff that needs to be there rather than, you know, just filling it with, you know, little bits just to make it full, you know, because people will buy into it, you know, and the acid test is in a club, you know, if you're making club music, you know, the acid test is people dance. It's good.
Yeah, look, there's nothing, there's no better feeling in the world than dropping your track and people keep dancing.
People
and,
losing
or,
their shit.
Or they, you know, they dance harder or they lose their shit. Yeah, for sure. Like that's you know, up there with hearing your own music on the radio, of which I've never done, which even though this track got Wandering Strangers got played on Triple J, I've still never heard it. I got a lot of text messages and phone calls from people like, oh, I just heard your track, but I've still never heard it. That would be an amazing kind of moment. And the last one is hearing somebody else play your track.
Yeah, like that's very exciting. Like, yeah.
That's you know, I've had a few people, you know, text me or tell me that they've done it, you know, and DJs that I respect and admire and people tell me that, you know, other, they've heard other people playing it, and it's just, it's such an amazing, and I, you know, I've heard other people play our stuff, and it's just, it's such an honor,
yeah,
when somebody else plays your music, because, you know, it just means that you've done something right, and that you've spent all this time kind of in the studio and in front of a computer going, oh, you know, just kind of crafting it, you know, and you kind of finish it, and like any piece of art, it's never truly finished, and you kind of send it out there into the world and cross your fingers and hope that everybody else likes it. And when somebody else is playing it, it's testament to the fact that they like it.
I think it's because it's so personal.
Yeah.
You get so close to it that, yeah, that, you know, that when you let go of it and it goes into the marketplace, it has to take on life of its own. Mm. So when it does, and, you know, when people play it, you know, obviously that's the biggest accolade you can get, because they don't even have to say they like it. Yeah. For you know, for me to play another person's piece of music, that means that I get it.
Yep.
I don't need to tell them I love it. Mm. I'm playing it. Mm. You know, because very selective over, yeah, you know.
Oh, for sure. As a DJ, you're essentially kind of like a shit filter. You know, you kind of yeah, sit there and music comes in. And I mean, you know, I don't mean that as in like, you know, some other music is shit, but it's just for you, you filter out the stuff that you don't like, and you're not going to play something
Mikey,
if you don't
you
like it.
You can say that. There's a sea of shit out there, yeah, to be honest. Sure.
But I mean, there's, you know, it's and for people out there in the kind of the clubbing world that are there to dance and kind of, you know, absorb the music and that sort of stuff, when they're following a DJ, they or a producer or whatever that they want to go and see, they're there to, you know, they trust that DJ, that DJ has spent the time listening to the music, and then when they play it because they genuinely love it or get it, you know, as you say. And so when another DJ plays your music, it's like, okay, great. You know,
yeah,
okay, somebody out there. There's somebody out there that doesn't think our music is shit.
Well, then
you
listen to it in a different light as well. When
totally, there's, you know, tunes that I've written that I didn't physically, I was sick of because I'd heard it too many times, yeah, and then somebody else plays it, and I'm like, oh wow.
And you can look around the room or the festival, wherever it's being played, and you can hear it like through other people's eyes, well, ears, should I say, you know, but you can see their enjoyment for it, and it gives you that lease of life of like, I remember where I was when I first got this track up and, yep, I first started making it, and by the time you finish it, you're sick of it,
yeah,
but hearing it in that environment, hearing somebody else play it, you know, I've been so nervous about not playing one of my tracks until I've heard another DJ play it.
Yeah.
And they, you know, where I, you know, I'm just done with it. I'm absolutely done with this track. And then you hear another DJ play it, and you look around, you see the response, and, you know, I can't wait to get home and dig my own track out,
yeah,
to play it, you know, because it's given me, you know, sort of confidence in one of my own pieces of music. Maybe that's just me, but I understand what you're saying.
Yeah, it's exciting, and it's a funny kind of way of looking at it, but it's just, yeah, it's important.
So while we're talking about production, what we, you know, we kind of have to talk about it is the breakbeat scene.
Yeah.
I'm happy
to talk about the breakbeat scene.
Okay.
Unlike some people, I'm sure, but yeah.
Well, it's not pointing fingers at me, because
no.
I volunteered this. Yeah. We come from a scene, which is breaks.
Yep.
Although, you know, I over the years I've definitely drifted into more of a sort of a kind of slight different sort of realm.
Yep.
You know, for no other reason apart from, you know, a lot of the breaks, the style of breaks I used to play just became very thin on the ground, and there just was less and less and less to choose from. And the way I view music is, if I can't find a piece of music in a certain genre that doesn't fit what I do, I'm not going to stop DJing.
Yep.
So I will look elsewhere.
Look elsewhere. Yeah.
You know, it's a different thing, because this goes with the label, and obviously you've released some breakbeat tunes on Lot 49. We have. And you know, it's the breaks I like. You know, that's why I was desperate to pick you up and to put your music out, because there wasn't many people that I was really feeling. But you guys were, you know, you're really doing it for me. So that's why, you know, that's kind of how we got involved musically. Mm. I know your relationship with the breakbeat scene is a lot more current than mine is.
Mm. There still is a breakbeat scene in Perth.
Well, there is a breakbeat scene worldwide. You know, yeah. there's not.
Oh no, I don't mean that there's not a breakbeat scene anywhere else. But I think definitely in Australia, there's not much of a breakbeat scene in some of the other cities in Australia. Became a bit of a dirty word for a while there, and
Was garage for a while.
So was garage, and now look at it. Yeah.
So listen, let's not write it off.
Yeah. Oh no. And look, I haven't. I mean, you know, I'm the last person to write breakbeat off, because it's definitely a sound that I've grown with and has given me the kind of the successes that I've been able to have in Perth and around the country in Australia, and it's the sound of Ambar, and it always will be. You know, as much as we might not play as much of it as we used to, and there was definitely a period where there was some breakbeat diehards that that weren't too happy about the fact that, you know, the sounds were starting to kind of, other sounds were infiltrating the Saturday nights there, because it was born as a sort of purely breakbeat club. And, you know, now we play everything from breakbeat to techno to electro to house to Mumbaton to drum and bass to trap and a little bit of dubstep, and, you know, but essentially the core sound of the club is still very much breakbeat. Mm. And there's still a lot of new breakbeat getting played there. There's still a lot of international breakbeat artists that are playing at the club. And, you know, with our festival Breakfest, which happens at the end of the year.
That's
like,
what I was going to mention.
Yeah, that's still very much a breakbeat festival. And, you know, we sell a bunch of tickets every year, and people come to listen to breakbeat. And it's just, I think a large part of it is because Ambar's been such a core of Perth that that the sound has stayed alive there. And because of all the DJs that have been residents there have still loved the sound and not just kind of dropped it and moved on to something else. And because of a festival like Breakfest, you know, and Boomtick as a kind of a greater organization still pushing and promoting the music, there's been new generations of breakbeat lovers. I mean, the young guys that are now our residents, you know, grew up on seeing us and coming to the festivals and that sort of stuff, and now they're playing breakbeat, and then now there's a new generation of guys that are coming up after them that are playing breakbeat.
Well, I think that's kind of what the problem we've suffered here in the UK is, that, like, you know, the breakbeat scene here in well, let's say Europe, really, is that you had like funky breaks, then you had like, you know, kind of more sort of deeper, or like sort of kind of breaks.
Yeah,
progressive is not actually a bad word. Yeah. It was kind of progressive breaks, which is more where I was at. A little, I say deeper, but deeper would give you an idea that it didn't go off. That's not the case.
No.
And then you had the more sort of like tear out breaks, the sort of like the, which is kind of morphed into 140 Jungle somehow.
They
repackaged it. and, you know, look, that I think that's what it was for me, is that a lot of people around me and a lot of people that represented the sort of sound I liked started to drift off, you know. And a lot of them drifted into techno and, you know, funny enough, you know, wherever they went, you know, so you're left in a scene. And then I guess the jumping into, say, like Funky Breaks, which, you know, you've always played a broad selection. You've always played right across the board. Mm. You know, I didn't.
Yeah.
You know, I was very fixated on a certain style of breaks.
Yeah.
So it wasn't so easy for me. Me playing Funky Breaks, I might as well have been playing it. I might as well just went and played drum and bass. You know, it's like it was that different to what I was known for. So I guess, you know, is that... Because you being a resident, I'm not going to put words in your mouth, but you being a resident, your repertoire had to be more broad than what I was as a guest DJ, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that was also definitely as a resident, you know, that you have that role. I mean, but also the way that that I program our residents and the way that I kind of have selected our residents and I guess decided whether or not they were kind of capable of being residents or not was whether or not they had the capacity to play at any time. And so, you know, all of our guys move around. We all play at 11 o'clock some weeks. We all play at 1 o'clock some weeks. We all play at 3 o'clock some weeks. We do closes. We do warm-ups. We do opens. We do, you know, and so all of our guys have developed this ability to kind of play anytime, anywhere, and therefore the blinkers are well and truly off. And it's for me, it was always an ethos that I felt that as a DJ, you know, I guess I'm a DJ first,
yeah,
and a producer, or, you know, sort of second, you know, and because it's important to be a DJ to be able to play anytime, anywhere,
versatile,
you know, being versatile. And because of that, I've, you know, my sets and you know, and with Black and Blunt, our sets, feels exactly the same as me. You know, like we change tempos and genres, and you know, in 90 minutes, you know, you'll hear a couple of different tempo changes and six different genres. And it's always been, you know, a kind of a desire that I've had to play the full spectrum of sounds. And now, you know, with Breakbeat, it made it capable for you know, residents like we have it at the club to be able to, you know, look further afield and not get disillusioned, I guess, with the Breakbeat sound. Because if the funky stuff wasn't really happening, there was heavier stuff that was taking off. And if that wasn't really happening, then there was deeper stuff that was taking off.
So you could move around within the genre.
Within the genre. And then, you know, if you needed some funkier stuff, you could look back and play some older stuff, because the newer stuff that you had, you were going to play later in your set. You know, so it didn't feel like you'd overplayed any particular track too much, because you might not have played a 3:30 to a close slot in a month.
Yep.
So you could go and, you know, find all those tunes and play those tunes.
You had a new take on it.
And you know, you could be excited about it. And so therefore it gave longevity to everything, because everybody wasn't just playing 1 till 5 or 1 till 3 every week. You know, everybody has been playing all around the place. And so everybody makes the most of being able to exercise, you know, flex that muscle, that funky muscle, or that deeper muscle, or that heavier muscle, you know. And therefore, the music that they have gets older, slower.
Yep.
You know, you don't get over it as quickly, because you're not kind of pigeonholed into one sound and one style and one type of set. So it just means that, it means that the sound for us has maintained, because, and, you know, now, like, I think Breakbeat is in probably the best place it's been in sort of 5 or 6 years. There's all this new stuff that's coming out that's, I don't know, people probably aren't even calling it Breakbeat.
Do you want to name check anyone?
I hate it when people put me on the spot like that. I mean, I'm you know, I really like the stuff that Martin Hawk is doing at the moment.
He's got a
really cool sound. It's big, it's heavy, but it's spacious and it's kind of stripped back. And stuff like Savage Skulls, which is, you know, those guys are writing, you know, P.O. to Pete is like, I just really liking the difference in kind of broken beat that people are doing. It's, you know, people, I guess you can, those,
more
I don't know.
Big whether, beat.
Yeah, it's stuff. Almost more big yeah. beaty sort yeah. of stuff, you know, and which is harping back to the time before breakbeat, you know, and yeah. it's just, it's experimenting with, you know, not kick, snare, kick, kick, snare, you know, it's like, let's throw the snares around, let's throw the kicks all around, you know, like, but yet use things like hi-hats and other kind of rhythmical elements to keep the roll and the drive to go going along, but yet move things out of place, that, you know, the kicks and the snares out of, into different places, so that the break is so unlike anything that you've ever kind of heard before. It's still a break beat, you know, like it's still a broken beat.
Yep.
And I just yeah, yeah. And you know, and stripping things like bass lines back to just nice clean 808s that kind of just hum and bounce and fill the room with sort of a wall of bass, but yet, like, you know, the riffs and that sort of stuff can sit up nice and high, and it doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to be kind of big cheesy sort of stuff. So
I think one of the problems with the, like, the 808 and using a lot of sub bass is that the way that you know, such a age, way that kids buy music now is through their computer. They listen to it. They preview a track on Beatport or iTunes, whatever it may be.
For a pair of laptop speakers.
So yeah, on laptop speakers. So they can't hear no sub. They can't really hear what the track's capable of doing. So a lot of those kind of stripped back tracks, they would go under the radar because they sounded sparse. They just sound like they were. Whereas the, you know, with the big sort of distorted bass line, you know, that's being filtered at the same time, it filled the speaker. Mm. So you're like, this sounds big, but you know, you got to have a bit of vision playing, and you need to trust some artists to know that what they're delivering.
Yeah, exactly. They know how to mix a track
people
down.
People like Maelstrom, you know, makes, you know, fantastic. You know, some of the stuff that's out on Boys Noise,
he's killing it.
You need to take a little bit of a risk and understand that these guys do know what they're doing, buy it, play it, and actually hear that, you know, they are reaching all the frequencies in a club. It's just that you can't hear them on a laptop speaker. Mm. That's the bitch.
Yeah.
So you've got to kind of trust that it's going to be good, you know, and, you know, at the end of the day, is, you know, people are very careful about what they buy. They want to spend X amount of money. They want to, you know, look, even going back to buying records, you know, I'd still get home and I'd buy a load of records I like that I'd never play.
Yeah.
And I still do it when I download tracks, you know. I'd say, like, the majority of the tracks that I buy, I don't play. I'd say, like, you know, maybe 20% of the music I buy, and I buy regularly, the same as when I was buying vinyl. I'd say about 20%, and that's been very generous, actually makes its way into my sets. But at the end of the day, I wouldn't take that back. I'm still buying music that I'm feeling.
Yeah. Yeah. You
know, still buying because it sounds good to me.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. There's a lot of really amazing music out there. I'm probably, I don't know, there have been moments in the last sort of 15 years where I've struggled to find good music. There's been a 6-month period where it's been really, really difficult to fill my sets up with something new and exciting, and I've been playing older sort of stuff or similar sort of stuff to, you know, what I'd been playing in the previous kind of 6 months. But I mean, at the moment, I'm, you know, I can't buy music fast enough. I can't absorb it fast enough, and I can't play it fast enough. And it's, you know, the genre hat is well and truly off, and people are okay with that now. There was a time when, you know, play some fucking breaks, mate. You know, play some fucking breaks. You know, that was a big thing at Amber. It was like, well, I'm not really feeling the breakbeat at the moment. You know, there's all this Wicked House that's coming out that I'm feeling, you know. And now people are much more, at least in Perth, and you know, are much more accepting of genre changes, tempo shifts, up, down, you know, all that sort of stuff. You know, playing Moomba, trap, you know, drum and bass, breakbeat, electro, techno. Like, lately I've been, you know, putting quite a lot of techno into my sets, and it's something that, you know, if you ask the punter on the floor, do you like techno, they might go, no, I don't. Yeah. But you put it in their set, you put it in your set, and you put it, you deliver it in the right way.
Delivery's everything.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden they're loving it, and they're coming up to you going, this breakbeat tune's amazing. And you're like, yeah, cool, okay.
Well, a lot of techno artists, the thing that's become very, it's very kind of fashionable for techno artists now is to end like, you know, the 8 bars with a breakbeat feel.
Yeah. Yep.
and it roll, because it's all about the rolling. And, you know, the bassline techno is, it has big, dirty bass lines. It kind of hits the spot that progressive breaks isn't there anymore. Mm. So it can, you know, a lot of percussion. It's got the vibe. You know, I remember when I first started playing Fabric, and I remember Rennie Pilgrim saying to me, this would be great if it had a break in it. And it's like, yeah, but like everyone's dancing, it's great anyway. Yeah. But, you know, just a memo to Rennie is like, yeah, they have break beats in them now.
They do. Yeah. Know, there's
10 years later.
Yeah. Yeah. There's some really good broken beat kind of techno and a lot of the really sort of stripped back melodic sort of stuff and slower stuff like 120 BPM. And yeah, I think it's an exciting time for electronic music. You know, aside from all of the, you know, the mainstream stuff and the big explosion of kind of EDM and, you know, where that's taken, there's still this undercurrent of just really, really solidly written, beautifully produced music out there that is worth listening to.
Well, that's a nice way to end. Thank you for coming and seeing me, Micah. Obviously, it's always a pleasure seeing you, and I really appreciate you making your way down from North London to the suburbs.
No worries, mate. Thanks for having me.
No, my pleasure. And hopefully next time I see you, it'll be in Australia.
Hopefully so.
Anyone you want to give a shout to?
Oh, just shouts out to all the Perth people, my family. You know, you guys are the people that keep me going, and thank you. And also thank you to everyone who... you know, put in for the possible campaign. You guys got me to Kazantip, and I can't thank you enough.
So that's about it for the first episode. We made it. Finished. Thank you very much for listening. I know it's a little bit rough around the edges, but I'm sure you agree it adds a little bit of charm. If you're interested in discussing any of the things that me and Micah raised in our conversation, head off to my Facebook page. And if you're after a track listing for this show, go to my website, meetkatie.com, and subscribe, and you'll receive a newsletter. Next episode, I've got Dylan Rhymes in for an interview. My long-serving business partner with Lot 49. It starts off badly and just gets worse. Thank you very much for listening. Take care.
Hey, this is Micah Black from Black and Blunt. This is oh shit, hold on.
This is me, Katie, and you're listening to Lowering the Tone.